Today, we will talk about the characteristics of Prakriti, nature, Purusha, witnesser, and yoga, union. So, Prakriti is the composite of 8 different characteristics that Krishna describes, which includes fire, earth, air, water, ether, manas, which is the thinking mind, buddhi, which is the delineating intellect, ahankar, ego. And the Purusha can be the lower Purushas, which are basically us who are reincarnating every now and then, and the ultimate Purusha, which is the Paramatma, which is the supreme witnesser, controller, enjoyer, supporter. So lot of times in Gita we will hear Krishna saying terms such as Bharta Bhokta Maheshwara, which means the Purusha, who is the knower of the field, is the supporter, witnesser, controller, and enjoyer. But never does Krishna say, in fact he goes on to say, that I am not the doer. Name parthasti kartavyam trishu lokeshu kinchana nan vapt aptayam vart evcha karmani. Or he will say, prakite kriyamarani gunah karmani sarvasha ahankar vimud atma kartaham iti manyate. Which is to say that the doership rests with the field or the nature, which is composed of the 3 gunas. Gunas are the influencing associations which will always try to model you in accordance with what they are and make it one of you. So that is the problem with tamas guna, which is the heaviest and the most dominant of the 3 gunas. That slowly, if you are unknowingly doing something, you create this cyclical neuronal pattern in the brain that will make you do that thing repeatedly, and it creates a habit. And hence, the risk with the Purusha lies in falling in the depths of becoming Prakriti. This is the only thing that has to be stopped, and that's why there are avataras and avdhutas that come on the earth every now and then to save, salvage, rescue these fallen ajas or the souls who are slowly getting entangled in the rajas and the tamas. They have lost the light-heightedness of the sattva. So what can bring us down are the gunas, and what can levitate us from the wrenches of Prakriti is also gunas. And yoga or yunjan or union represents life. Yoga is basically the time when the Purusha and Prakriti exist together in symbiosis most of the times as life. So all of us who have this panch bhautik sharir and this sukshma sharir, which is composed mostly of the mind and the ego and the intellect, are composed of the gross and the subtle elements of Prakriti. Panch bhut sharir is the gross element of Prakriti, and manas buddhi ahankar is the subtle element of Prakriti. But neither of these 2 things represents the real you. The real you is the karan sharir, which is underneath the sthul sharir, gross body, and sukshm sharir, subtle body, because it is the causal body. That's the atman. So the atman is, as we know, akledyam, adahyam, achedyam, soshate. It is nothing that can be penetrated, burnt, moistened, or dried, because it is Nainam chindanti shastrani, nainam dehati pavaka, nach nainam kledantiya apuna soshyati maruta. It is something which is not be damaged by the penetration of a sword, or the heat of the fire, or dried by the air, or moistened by water, as he says repeatedly. So basically, he's trying to say it's above the elemental influence of the gross Prakriti elements, the fire, earth, air, water. And the closest it resembles to is the ether or the vacuum or the empty space, is what the unmanifest soul represents itself as. But yoga also represents the state of securing our soul nature, which represents Bharta, Bhokta, Maheshwara, and the way to do it is described very well multiple places, is yada hinendriyartheshu na karma sanushyate sar sankalp sanyasi yoga rudas dochyate, which means yada hinendriyartheshu, one who is not attached to the indriya, nor to the karma, and one who is not doing the activity because he wants to rejoice into the karmaphal or the rewards of the activity that has been performed. Udasinvat asino, that's another word that is repeatedly used, which means without caring, just doing things based on the dharma. So my friends, of the eight elements of Prakriti, the highest is intellect. Intellect is what establishes dharma, the knowledge of right and wrong. Intellect is what makes you do things in the mode of nishkam karma, which is doing the activity without seeking the rewards. Because the biggest rewards, the happiness, will come to us when we are least expecting it and burdening the Prakriti to give us the reward. The laws of karma automatically, ultimately determine that you will get the rewards. But when you are not expecting any rewards while you are pursuing your dharma or the righteousness and the right thing to do, whether you are doing it at work, whether you are doing it with your spouse, whether you are doing it with your kids, family, community, anywhere. Every place where you establish dharma, which is how would they feel if they were in my shoes, and doing it from a neutral Brahman perspective to preserve the righteousness, is trying to establish and make the neutrality of Brahman even more neutral, which is what it wants to be in, the samta, sambhav, sattva state, which is the state of balanced neutrality. So, it's important to understand that whenever we are in this life, which is the yoga, which is the union of the Prakriti elements with the Purush element of witnesser, enjoyer, to enjoy it in the right way, we have to pursue the path of Shreya, which is the right thing to do. Because whenever we pursue Preya, which is the short-term pleasure-seeking abilities, that is going down in the guna of Rajas. Because Krishna says, what tastes like nectar in the beginning will taste like poison in the end, is driven by the desire to do work or enjoy the sensual pleasures. That's the Rajas Guna. It gets things done very rapidly, but on the downside, in the end, it will cause pain most of the times. So as the Bharta Bhokta Maheshwara, if we want to enjoy the activities, if we want to enjoy this existence in the life of yoga, it is very important that we do things as Udasinvat Asino, which is without caring. Yo na hrishyati, na dveshyati, na sochati, na kanchati, udasino dasino, that kind of nature. So you're not getting immediately pleasured, nor grieved, nor having a lot of craving, yearning, kanchati. Then we are in the right mode of dharma and pursuit of the activities. And yoga is the highest state that you have to use to overcome the gunas. Tapasvibhyo dikho yogi, jnanibhyo api mato dikha, karmibhyascha dikho yogi, tasmad yogi bhavarjun. The yogi, or the guy who has perfected the art of union of the Purusha with the Prakriti in the realm of life, is higher than the knowledge seeker, is higher than the austere penance performer, and also higher than the person who is doing sacrifice. So, although all the karma has to be done as sacrifice, tapasvibhyo dikho yogi, jnanibhyo api mato dikha, karmibhyascha dikho yogi. So the karma performer, tasmad yogi bhavarjun. So the three people that it's above is the tapasvi, the the austere performers, the jnani who are the knowledge seekers, and the karma doers. But the yogi, real guy, is the guy who is doing sarva sankalp sannyasi, who is working in the karma but not seeking the results. That's the definition of yogi, who is not seeking objects of sensual gratification and who is not seeking the results of the rewards of the karma performed. That gets you to become a yogi. If you are in that mind state, you are a yogi and you are higher than all these people that Krishna regards very high as he has said. That a jnani is the most dear to him of all the people. But even yogi is higher than the jnani. And yogi, as I said, is the state of highest perfection, using the intellect to preserve the dharma or the brahmanic neutrality, not seeking personal sense gratification or prayer, not seeking activities and rewards in return, because that gets you in karma bandhan. And if you want to overcome the karma bandhan, you have to do things in brahmanic neutrality using the intellect or the dharma, and that gets established as the highest kind of yogi. I hope you like this audio. Thank you.